which they should have done, which had restricted the slave trade to London, although it was a very small thing until that date. It hadn't really become that important at that time. Probably that's why they didn't think it was worth continuing the act. What it meant was the slave trade was open to whoever was able to get it quickest. Now, unfortunately, this important milestone in Liverpool's modern history, the building of the first dock, is connected with the decision taken by a few people to become involved in slave trade. And I will deal with it again next talk about London. But we really do have to understand that because they didn't think there was anything much wrong with it, because they didn't think that the people they were enslaving were the same as their own equal anyway, that whilst we in our century would think that that was an important issue, a moral issue, it wasn't for them. And you would be disappointed to find how little discussion there would have been in the early 18th century about the slave question as a moral one. It was a financial question, a question of advancement, and a question where individuals who started with nothing could end up with a great deal of something. A kind of new way forward in the 18th century. We have not yet reached the age of enlightenment and nationality and Voltaire and questioning things and the sovereignty of the people and all that stuff, which we get later on in the 18th century. It was just a good way of making money. But you couldn't do it with a wooden jetty stuck out into the middle of a pool somewhere. You had to have a dock. And, of course, there was this question of building something for the king's ships. So then, in November of 1708, the town council, and remember, it's completely self-chosen at this time, they then asked their MP, one of the Norris family of Speke Hall's owners, and Thomas Johnson, who's Thomas Speke's named after, who was our MP, and Johnson is described in the Dictionary of National Biography as the founder of modern Liverpool. Now they're asked to go to London, to Parliament, and ask for a parliamentary act to build a dock and to find an engineer. Now, you have to have a parliamentary act for everything in those days. That was one of the main, I think I said this before my talks, that was one of Parliament's main duties until the middle of the 19th century, passing hundreds and hundreds of acts for small changes to be made in nearly every area of life. You didn't have, it's not like... So Johnson does most of the work. Norris was there, but not very often. Johnson does most of the work. He gets permission to build the dock. He also gets a parliamentary act for the first school, the Blue Coat, which will come to next week. And he gets permission to build the dock, and he finds an engineer. Now, the engineer concerned for the first dock is a man called Thomas Steers. Now, Steers doesn't have any proper biography. There's a book written nearly a century ago, not far short of a century ago, by a man called Henry Pepys, which is very interesting. But he's a very interesting character, Steers. There's been arguments about whether he was born here or whether he came over with King William's army from Holland, or he came over with William's army. Anybody who reads about King William knows that he always looked after his own. And one of the things he did when he came to this country was to find jobs for all the people that had put him there. Hundreds came over with him, preferment. Thomas Sears was an engineer. He had a job high in London. And this, of course, is an enclosed space. We all want to talk history, we It's an enclosed space where you can regulate the water, incoming and outgoing, at a certain level, which allows you to bring ships in of a certain draft, of a certain size, and then they can be kept in quiet and peace in a natural enclosed harbour while they are loaded and unloaded. That is simply what a dock is. Now, there are three things that I want to say about this. I went on a tour of the dock recently. They do a tour now in on the edge of Liverpool on there, and then nice little chaps, and they did very well. And you can go in there and see what it was like. During the commentary of the tour, they didn't mention the slave trade. Maybe they thought it was unnecessary. It's not for me to say. But I would have thought that the compulsion to do things, there has to be a reason for it. Anyway, they didn't mention that. But they were also a bit harsh on Sears because of the technical mistakes that they made in the dock. For instance, the stone not being hard enough, the walls crumbling. When the ships came into them, they weren't strong enough because they used local stone and it wasn't good enough. Well, Samuel Smiles, in his great book on engineers, it's a very quirky book, but it's an amazing document. He actually says that it's unfair to criticise the founders of a particular engineering science because they didn't know. They were at the beginning of things. So they weren't to know what was going to fail. And if they hadn't started with these things, then the people who came after them, the people who obviously built the docks later, all the great dock masters like Lister and Hutchinson and Hartley, from Mickey's name then, Jesse, all these great people wouldn't have improved things if they hadn't known the mistakes that Sears made on his dock. So, I don't know, unless I built something, which I haven't, I wasn't even very good at Lego, unless I built something, I wouldn't really like to criticise an 18th century engineer on his mistakes. The other thing that the mistake they all made was, and this is a mistake they all made, all of them, whether it was money or government, I don't know, but they all built docks that were almost obsolete by the time they were open. The one thing they never seemed to judge about was that they were building for their ships that they knew, but that within a generation, or less in some cases, the ships would be too big to go into their own docks. And they never had this, well, let's build for something that it's too big now, but in 25 or 30 years might be the right size. The Albert Dock opened 1846, was almost obsolescent before it was opened. Mr. Jarvis's book on the dock engineers makes some good comments, some good discussion of these questions. But certainly, Sears set out to do what he was asked to do. Needless to say, there was never enough money. The project was, like all of our projects, fraught with difficulty. When it opened in 1715, it's only a partial opening, and they continued working on it till 1719, 1721. And when the Mulberry came in, the first ship, it was pretty much like one of them opening ceremonies, where they're still painting the place at 5 to 12 on the night before it opens.